Reverend Father Rahman Yohannes, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and fellow enthusiasts of ancient world history and literature, a warm welcome to all of you on this special evening, where we have the privilege of gaining invaluable insights into the recently released work, Assyria, directly from the esteemed author and historian, Professor Eckart Frahm. Professor Frahm is a distinguished professor of Assyriology in the Department of Near Eastern Languages and Civilizations at Yale University. As one of the world's foremost experts on the Assyrian Empire, he has authored or co-authored six books on ancient Mesopotamian history and culture. Today, we embark on a journey through the rise and fall of the world's first empire, guided by the expertise of Professor Frahm himself, a scholar whose work has illuminated the mysteries of this fascinating civilization. Together, we will gain a deeper understanding of the epic story that is Assyria and its formative role in global history. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming the Honourable Chris Bowen, MP, Federal Member for Macmahon and Minister for Climate Change and Energy. Over the years, Chris has been a strong advocate for the Assyrian community's interests and cultural preservation. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Chris.
Well, thank you very much, Stephanie, and thank you all for coming out tonight. Shlomo lochon. And as we celebrate the Indigenous people of Iraq, I also celebrate the Indigenous people of Australia and pay my respects to our First Nations people. Well, friends, when I saw this book advertised online, I thought, wow, we all know about Assyria. We all know the rich Assyrian history, but we all have so much more to learn. I know I do. Because the Assyrian history is so rich and so long and so strong that there is always more to learn. And I ordered this book, and it's hard to get. So one of the things we might ask Eckhart is how we can get more copies of this book in Australia. But eventually it came. Actually, Eckhart sent me a copy as well as me ordering a copy. And I read it and learned much. And one of the things I learned was that in the 1800s, there was a period where Assyriomania took off around the world, where everybody came interested in Assyria in the United Kingdom and the United States, and everyone was interested in Assyria for a period. Eckhart writes about that period, and maybe his book will generate a new period of Assyriomania around the world where people have a new and profound interest in the wonderful Assyrian culture. So when I saw this book and I contacted Professor Frahm and said, we have a large and vibrant and strong Assyrian community in my community, and how would you feel about coming on and talking to my community about this book? And he said straight away, immediately replied and said, of course. And so we're set tonight up. So tonight's not to hear from me, it's to hear from Professor Frahm. He's going to talk for half an hour or so about his book and show us a presentation. For those of you who haven't yet had the chance to read it, who would be most of you, I think, because it's very hard to get. And then we're going to do Q&A, and you can ask Professor your questions. So thank you all for coming. It's enough from me, and I know we're going to have a good night. And even those of you who know already so much, as you all do, you're all experts in Assyrian history, but I think we'll all get something out of tonight and this wonderful edition. So without further ado, over to Professor Frahm.
Many thanks for this very kind introduction, and many thanks for actually inviting me over. First time ever that I'm giving a lecture in Australia. And obviously, I would have liked to do it in person, but since it is 2:15 or 2:20 a.m. in New Haven, it almost feels as though I were there in person, considering that I feel a little bit like I'm jet lagged. At any rate, it is a great honor and a pleasure to give this little lecture on Assyria to all of you. I will now actually get my PowerPoint started, so bear with me while I'm setting it up, and do let me know if anything goes wrong. I hope you can all see it. So, usually, when I give lectures on Assyria or other topics in Mesopotamian history to an audience outside the university setting, I feel like I have to justify the need to actually study the ancient world, in general and Assyria in particular. And one way for me to do this is sort of to quote Winston Churchill, even though this quotation is only ascribed to him, who allegedly once said, "The farther back you can look, the farther forward you're likely to see." And I do think this is correct. And I hope in my short presentation tonight, I will be able to show you that there are indeed aspects of Assyrian history, for instance, the way it was shaped in certain moments by plague and by climate change, that really hold lessons for us today. But at the same time, of course, with an audience like yours, the modern Assyrians, I might not actually have to sell the Assyrians at all. You will probably all be genuinely interested anyway. And thus I can actually start this little presentation without further ado. I will talk primarily about the Assyrian Empire, that is the Assyria of the 8th and 7th centuries BCE. That's the Assyria that's best known to everyone. That's the Assyria that's reflected in the Hebrew Bible, about which the Greek and Roman historians are writing. And it is obviously the Assyria that has probably shaped the world more than any other avatar of this ancient civilization. But it is actually quite interesting that when you look back, when you look at the earlier history of Assyria, that things actually look quite different. Assyria is a place that went through a number of metamorphoses that changed repeatedly quite substantially. And it is quite interesting also to study Assyrian history with these many changes in mind. So let us first go back to the beginnings. And of course, where are the beginnings to be found? That's a question one needs to ask. And answers to this question are difficult to have. When we look at legends, then we find different answers. According to Genesis 10, according to the Hebrew Bible, the beginning of Assyria is marked by the appearance of Nimrod or Ashur, depending on how one translates this passage. The Greek historians considered as the founder of the Assyrian kingdom a certain Ninus, and the Assyrians themselves claimed that a certain Tudia was their first ruler. So there are these different traditions, all in themselves quite interesting, but not really historically accurate. Where does it really start? Well, what we can say is that eastern Iraq, northeastern Iraq, the area that brought forth the Assyrian kingdom eventually, is actually an area that plays a big role in the sort of early history of mankind in general. In fact, already around 70,000 BCE, there were Neanderthals roaming the landscape. Bones of them were found in the Shanidar cave in eastern Kurdistan. And what you can also see on this slide is that, Assyria, or what would later become Assyria, was an important part of the so-called Fertile Crescent, marked here by this crescent-shaped line. That is an area that ranges from the southern Levant along the Taurus Mountains in the north to the Zagros Mountains in the east. This is the area where, so of around 10,000 BCE, human beings for the first time actually settled in villages, began to domesticate plants and animals, began a completely new lifestyle, a development that has been characterized as the Neolithic Revolution. And Assyria played an important role in this. One of the key sites of this period, Hassuna, is very close to the city of Nineveh in northern Iraq. Another revolution a little later, the fourth millennium BC, however, occurred mostly in the south of Iraq, and that is the famous urban revolution, which was marked by the emergence of large cities, most importantly the city of Uruk, shown here by this red circle, and also, among other things, the invention of writing. Uruk had probably as many as 60,000 people. And the Uruk civilization and then the civilization of southern Iraq that developed within the next centuries slowly and steadily also moved to the north. And it is sort of in the mid third millennium BCE that we can trace the beginnings of what one could really claim was a genuinely Assyrian civilization. This civilization began, we can trace its beginnings in the city of Ashur, to which Assyria, of course, has its name. It's the name of its religious capital. It's the name of the main Assyrian god. Ashur, located kind of in the south of what would later on become Assyria, some 100 kilometers or so south of the modern city of Mosul, excavated by a German team beginning in 1903. These excavations have continued on and off through time up to today. This here is a photo that I took myself in the only excavation campaign at Ashur in which I participated myself in 2001. And even now, starting last year, new excavations are being conducted at Ashur, now headed by Karin Ratner of the University of Munich. This is a map of Ashur on the left. You see it's a city of on a rocky crag, which is directly near the Tigris River. And on the right, you see a view of the city from the ziggurat, the temple tower of Ashur, towards the west. So this is where it all starts. And Ashur is actually also the one place where archaeologists have been able to trace all the major periods of Assyrian history, starting with the early period, beginning around 2500, and then through the Old Assyrian, the Middle Assyrian, and the Neo-Assyrian period, about which I will speak at some length in the next minutes. The earliest traces of what can really describe as genuinely Assyrian culture were found in the area of the Ishtar Temple in the center of the city of Ashur, probably along with the temple of the god Ashur, the oldest temple in the city. The earliest traces of this temple can be dated to roughly 2500. Ishtar was the goddess of war and love, and was a deity who was also worshipped, even though not always under the same name, in the city of Nineveh and also in the city of Arbela, modern Erbil. So it seems that Assyrian civilization from early on was not only dominated by the male god Ashur, but also by this rather fascinating and very contradictory female deity Ishtar. Among the most interesting finds from the Ishtar temple, apart from these little altars that you can see here on the left, were some 60 or so clay figurines, one of them depicted here on the right of the slide, that seem to depict or represent members of the Assyrian elite around 2500 BCE. These statuettes were put on benches in front of what seems to have been the pedestal for the goddess Ishtar, so essentially representing the person they depicted in perpetual prayer before the goddess. And what is particularly interesting is that quite a few of them actually represent women. At any rate, those of you who identify as Assyrians, I would say, can find in these figurines your earliest ancestors in a way. When you look at them closely, you see that in terms of their artistic representation, they're clearly influenced by artistic styles from the Mesopotamian South. And that also applies to politics in early Ashur. So it seems as though in, well, this period of the second half of the third millennium, Ashur was often under the rule of some of the large and powerful states of the Mesopotamian South. First, the kingdom of Agade, and then the kingdom of Ur. The first ruler of Ashur, whose name is known to us, was a certain Etiti. And he was either an independent ruler or he was a representative of the kings of Agade. Another ruler, a certain Sarikum, who was in office in the mid-21st century BCE, was a vassal of the kings of Ur, named one of his daughters after one of their kings, King Shulgi, and sent a large delegation to the south, to Ur, in order to engage in trade. And here we see for the first time something that will define Assyrian civilization for quite some time, namely a certain commercial spirit. The Assyrians were from early on traders, and we will talk about this in more detail in a moment. Independence was achieved apparently by another ruler, probably from the late 21st century BCE, whose name is Tsilulu, whose seal is depicted here on the right, and you can see him sort of treading upon some slain enemies. So he apparently achieved independence for Ashur by means of warfare. One thing that's quite interesting about that seal is that it actually includes the statement Ashur is king, and that would be the god Ashur. And here we have for the first time the somewhat theocratic credo that would define Assyrian statehood for quite some time, because in Ashur, the king is not an earthly man, but instead it is the god of the city. Tsilulu, or Tsilulu, however you want to pronounce the name, was not the founder of the dynasty of hereditary rulers who came in office around 2000 BCE, though, inaugurating the so-called Old Assyrian period. That instead was a certain Puzo Ashur. So it is with this Puzo Ashur that the Old Assyrian period begins, when Ashur begins to emerge as an independent city-state, not yet a territorial state, with a very interesting political organization, very different from the very autocratic structure of Assyria in imperial times, almost the opposite. Because what we see here is, what the Greco-Roman historian Polybius might have described as a mixed constitution. There is an hereditary ruler in place. He's called a rubaum or vaklum. He's not called a king, quite interesting, because again, as I mentioned before, the real king of Ashur is the god Ashur. But this ruler doesn't really have that much power, or I should say he shares the power that he has with a number of additional institutions, most importantly the so-called city assembly, the alum, as it was called in Assyrian. This was an assembly of all the free men of Ashur who would assemble in a space near the Ashur temple, near the so-called step gate, where this assembly would, among other things, decree, or resolve legal issues and actually promulgate laws, a few of which are known to us from clay tablets. And finally, there was a so-called limum, an official who headed a city hall, who was in charge of weights and measurements and also of taxation. This was an office that was only held by those who had it for only a year, and in which you were apparently elected by lot. Ashur, during this early period, was also a remarkably peaceful state. And again, this is a contrast to, the Assyria, as it is well known from later sources. It gained its wealth not from campaigns, not from military action, but rather from trade. Trade particularly conducted between the city of Ashur and a place in Anatolia, some 1,000 kilometers or 600 miles or so to the northwest of Ashur, which was called Karnesh, modern Kultepe, where a colony of Assyrian traders lived. Here are the remains of some of the houses that these traders inhabited. And here is a depiction, a reconstruction of how these houses might have looked like. It is actually from Karnesh that we have most of our written documentation about early Ashur. Some 24,000 clay tablets. You see that the Assyrians wrote, like everyone in Mesopotamia at the time, on clay, which is great for us, for scholars, because clay tablets essentially indestructible. They may break, but they will fundamentally survive, even if they are not baked, only sun-dried, whereas, of course, parchment and papyrus would be perishable writing materials in Iraq and would not survive. But this is the reason why we can reconstruct the history of Assyria and of Mesopotamia in general in such detail. From these texts, we get some interesting details about how the trade the Assyrian merchants were engaged in actually worked. So what they did is actually quite simple. They imported textiles from Babylonia and tin from Iran and probably from regions as far away as Uzbekistan, and also produced textiles in Ashur. The women of Ashur were active in this respect and also actually managed their households when their merchant husbands were away. We have a lot of letters written by these women, which are among the most interesting sources from this period. The merchants would then bring the tin and the textiles on with donkey caravans to Carnish and sell them there, essentially for silver, also for gold, which then would be invested again in tin and textiles. And all of this essentially was highly profitable. So this trade went on probably into the 17th century or so BCE. And then, for reasons that are still not fully understood, because here our sources suddenly become very scarce, it breaks off. It has probably to do with the rise of the Hittites in Anatolia. And then we have essentially for the 16th period century or so, we have very few sources. We don't really know what's going on. When the dust settles, though, Ashur actually emerges as Assyria, as a territorial state that, as time goes by, during what we now call the Middle Assyrian period, expands in all directions, particularly towards the west. And by the 13th century BCE, essentially has reached the Euphrates border. This is now basically what you have. And this is a state now kind of much more similar to the other geopolitical entities of the ancient Near East than the old Assyrian city-state was. It's a state that is ruled by kings, some of whose names are listed here. And the first ruler who assumed the title of king was this Ashur-uballit, quite an interesting and important character, ruler in the 14th century BCE, clearly very eager to be considered an equal among the various rulers of the territorial states of the late Bronze Age, including the Egyptian pharaoh. So here is a letter that he writes to him, probably actually to Amenophis IV, that's the famous Akhenaten. Thus, Ashur-uballit, king of Assyria, great king, your brother, note that he now calls himself king, and not just king, he calls himself great king. He considers himself an equal partner of pharaoh, the Babylonian king, the Hittite king, and he addresses the pharaoh as his brother. And then he talks about his desire to have gold shipped to him because, as he says, he's engaged in building a new palace. And that's also something new. In the old Assyrian period, these hereditary rulers seem not to have had a palace. They had no court. All this changes now. And another change is that with kingship actually comes kind of a strong emphasis on military conquest. This here is a quote from the so-called Middle Assyrian coronation ritual from about the same time. Ashur is still king, as we can see here. This is what the high priest of Ashur actually shouts on the occasion of the coronation of the Assyrian king. But there is now also this earthly king. And one of his most important tasks, as this text makes very clear, is to expand his land with his just scepter. So it's very clear the Assyrian kings have as their task to expand their borders. And as we saw when we looked at the map that I just showed you, they did this very successfully. Around 1200, though, there came slowly but steadily another crisis. It had been caused by, well, events in the far west, in the Levant, on the Eastern Mediterranean, the most famous of which is the onslaught by the so-called Sea Peoples, depicted here on an Egyptian relief, who destroyed many cities along the Eastern Mediterranean. other groups of people who moved in. There were massive migrations during this time, destroyed the Hittite capital of Hattusha, and the Hittite kingdom was essentially eliminated. This did not immediately affect Assyria. Actually, around 1100, the Assyrian king Tiglath-Pileser I is able, not least because of the chaos in the west, to conduct for the first time a campaign that brings Assyrian troops to the Mediterranean, where they wash their weapons in the sea. But not that much later, we read in an Assyrian chronicle that, like a flood's raging water, the Aramean houses increased, plundered the crops of Assyria, conquered and took many fortified cities of Assyria. And later we read that all the harvest of Assyria was ruined. So in the wake of these attacks by the sea peoples, new geopolitical players made an appearance on the political scene in the Middle East, the most important of them being the Arabs and the Israelites, and of course also the Arameans, who I mentioned here for the first time. And they appear initially as enemies of Assyria. They attack Assyria. They actually managed to, conduct raids even within the Assyrian core area. Eventually, of course, as you all know only too well, the Assyrians and the Arameans will kind of undergo a fusion. The Assyrians will endorse Aramean language. In the 7th century, Aramean becomes more and more the dominant language in the Assyrian kingdom. But by this time, there's still a substantial amount of enmity involved. And it could all have ended here. This could have been the end for Assyria, just as it was the end for the Hittite states. But it wasn't. Actually, the Assyrians managed to somehow get back on their feet. Here on this map, you see how the Assyrian state had contracted by around 1,000. In pink is sort of the core area that was still somewhat under Assyrian control. But as time went by, up to, let's say, 850 or so, and that's the purple area on this map, a number of very energetic kings had managed to reconquer the lost territories. Kings, as you can see on this slide, who all took on the names of earlier Middle Assyrian kings, clearly with the intention of reconquering the lands that those kings had once conquered for the first time. And this is why the Italian scholar Mario Liverani has called this period between, let's say, 934 and 858 the Reconquista period. This was facilitated, this revival of Assyrian civilization, it was facilitated by climate change. The migrations that began around 1200 were probably also caused by increased drought levels. Now precipitation increased again. You can see it here on this slide. Around 925 BCE or so, rainfall in Assyria begins to be much more plentiful again. And the Assyrian kings made good use of it. They write in the inscriptions that they built granaries all over the place in the new cities that they founded, and thus, of course, added to the wealth of the kingdom. Something else happened. The city of Ashur was finally given up as the seat of the royal court, and under Ashurnasirpal II in the 9th century BCE, the royal court was moved to the city of Nimrud or Kalach. And it is there that for the first time we see some specimens of Assyrian art that would become typical for that art. Here, some Assyrian palaces, large palaces, gigantic palaces, so big that Ashur wouldn't have sufficed and provide the space for them. Here, carved orthostats with winged genies and sacred trees, typical for Assyria. Some other ones here, they were originally painted. And on the right, you see an attempt here made here at Yale to reconstruct the original color of those reliefs. Here, the famous bull colossi from Assyrian palaces. These ones here actually from the palace at Dur-Shuarukin, slightly later, majestic, gigantic, up to 50 tons in weight. On the plinth, you can sometimes see sort of incised rather crudely board games that were apparently played by the soldiers who guarded those gates and were probably enormously bored while doing so. So you see here the sublime and the mundane really nicely united. And then also really very impressive Assyrian jewelry, golden crown from the tomb of an Assyrian queen from the 8th century, actually a very insignificant queen, the wife of a very insignificant king, and yet this is a spectacular crown. As you can see, the treasures found in those tombs actually rival the treasures from the tomb of Tutankhamun in Egypt, and it's unlucky that were found in 1989, just before the Iraq War of 1990, and thus never really gained the public attention that they actually deserve. Now, there was another kind of small crisis, eventually actually a fairly substantial one, starting with the reign of Shalmaneser III, probably sort of around 824. You can't really see that when you look at the king list as we have it, because just one king after another, they are all from the same family. Everything seems fine here, but we know that during this time, the crown actually had little to say, and power was mostly in the hands of a number of important administrators and generals. Some left inscriptions. Up to then, this was essentially a privilege for kings. Only kings were allowed to leave such inscriptions. Now, those generals and administrators do so as well. This is the time when, for a while, the famous Assyrian queen, Queen Sammuramat, rules on behalf of her son, Adad-nirari III, this queen who later on would be celebrated in Greek legend as Semiramis. So the kings are weak. It's not so clear, though, that this was necessarily, at least at the beginning, so much to the detriment of the Assyrian state. Actually, archaeological surveys have established that, for instance, on the Khabur River, the number of settlements during this time increases, and it seems agrarian production increases too, so that one gets the impression that these individuals, these magnates, as they were sometimes called, made good use of the power they now held. But between 765 and 745, Assyria really is in crisis. You see this from the Assyrian Eponym Chronicle, which gives one important event for every year. Usually it talks about campaigns, but during these years, these 20 years, the army and the king mostly stay in the land. And in addition to that, there are a number of rebellions in key Assyrian cities, including the city of Ashur, that's Libyali, in Arapra, in Gusana, and elsewhere. Things do not look good, and it's not, I think, an unlikely hypothesis that the main cause for this crisis was actually an epidemic, something we are, of course, only too familiar with from our experiences from the past years, because there are plagues, according to the chronicle, in the year 765 and 759. They seem to have raged all throughout Assyria, and they certainly led to a massive loss in wealth and in life, and probably really to a massive economic contraction. Usually, of course, when there's plague in the ancient world, you expect that this will cause political decay. And here are some examples for that. I recommend the book by Kyle Harper on the fate of Rome, where he talks about the Antonine Plague, the Plague of Cyprian, the Plague of Justinian as possible causes for the slow decline and eventual fall of the Roman Empire. In Assyria, though, strangely enough, the situation is quite different, because in 744, this period of crisis ends abruptly with the rise, with the ascension to the throne of King Tiglathpileser III, depicted on this relief here, and within just some 15 years or so, he manages to double the size of the Assyrian kingdom and essentially, I would claim, actually create the Assyrian Empire. It is only now that we can really call this an empire, a large political body. He has a definition, or at least a set of criteria for empire, a large political body ruling over territories outside its original borders with a central power and a periphery that has to, send its wealth to the center, and a great deal of diversity, ethnic, religious, cultural, linguistic, and so on and so forth. All this is, I think, really something we can find here doing the rain optic lapis laser for the first time. And I would claim and have claimed in this book that I've written that this is the moment when Assyria becomes the world's first empire. It's certainly remembered as such in the Bible and in Greek and Roman sources. So the question then, of course, is how is that possible? And what I would say is that most likely, and what this shows us, is that history is not necessarily determined by rules, by laws. You can adapt, and Tiglath-Pileser probably did. He realized there was loss of wealth, there was loss of labor, and he embarked on a campaign of military conquest and annexation to make up for these losses, and also by means of deporting lots of people from the periphery, make up for the loss of workmen that the Assyrians had suffered in the years preceding his reign. Of course, this also means this epidemic cannot have totally devastated Assyria, and it seems also likely that, of course, the lands conquered by Tiglath-Pileser were probably affected by this plague as well. At any rate, Tiglath-Pileser sort of creates the Assyrian Empire as it then becomes known all over Western Asia and all over the world eventually. With warfare, here is a drawing of the famous reliefs showing the attack on the city of Lachish during Sennacherib's attack on Judah, which is also described at great length in 2 Kings in the Hebrew Bible. He, as I already mentioned, annexed the places that he conquered. That is, he didn't just leave vassal kings in place. He created new provinces. Eventually, there were some 75 provinces. New roads were created, communication networks were very, very efficient, very, very fast, allowed communication via letters over long distances in very short time. And as I already mentioned as well, deported hundreds of thousands of people. It's important to keep in mind here that these deportations were not meant as death marches or so. The people were not meant to die. They were treated quite well. We have evidence for that from letters. The idea was, on one hand, by means of these deportations to make sure that the internal solidarity within conquered communities would be dissolved, and on the other hand, simply to have workforces wherever they were needed, be it on construction sites in the Assyrian core areas or in lands that needed to be developed somewhere in the east. So this is what Tiglath-Pileser essentially implemented and what the kings following him did as well. We know enormous amount of stuff about those very kings, so much so that I could talk to you for hours, but we don't have that time. Here are two kings who were particularly significant and important. I just show them to you, Sargon II and his crown prince Sennacherib. Sennacherib, the builder of Nineveh. Here's this photo I took myself at Nineveh in 2001. When you look at the city wall here, you see it's some 12 kilometers long. It's really, really large. It's a gigantic city. It's called the Great City, Ir HaGedolah, in the Book of Jonah for a reason. This is where the large palaces were built that also define Assyria, and where eventually, of course, also perhaps Assyria's most famous king, Ashurbanipal, found his residence. Depicted here on a relief, Ashurbanipal, who engaged in warfare, as seen here, who is famous for his his hunting expeditions, especially with the lions, and of course also for the art representing all of this, which is the high point in Assyria, the peak in Assyrian art, but who is also famous as the literate king. And here you see, even when he was hunting, he had a stylus tucked into his belt, and it is from his libraries at Nineveh that he created that famous text, such as the 11th tablet of the Epic of Gilgamesh, where the flood story come. Here, attempt at the British Museum, where most of these tablets actually ended up, some 30,000 or so, to show how these tablets looked like, what different sizes they had, and so on. Ashurbanipal also claims that he was successful in economic terms. He writes in one of his inscriptions that there was plenty of rainfall, that grain grew happily, and that there was plenitude and abundance during his reign. Now, the reality was probably a little less impressive. In fact, among other things, Ashurbanipal did not go on campaigns on his own, even though he claimed so in his inscriptions, but rather stayed at home, as you can see here on this famous image from his north palace at Nineveh. And it also seems as though, well, the economy didn't go so well altogether. There seems to have been decreasing rainfall rather than increasing. So what he claims here about the increasing rainfall is probably simply not true. And all these things may have contributed to the eventual fall of the empire, of the Assyrian Empire, which happened just a few years after Ashurbanipal died in 631, and happened very fast. Unlike the fall of the Roman Empire, which was a matter of centuries, it happened really just within a decade or two. We know quite well what happened in terms of events. I'm not going to go into detail here. We can see that, well, the various well players, international players in the fall of the Assyrian Empire were the Babylonians, especially King Nabopolassar came to the throne in 626, and the Medes in the east. The Egyptians intervened. Even the Judeans eventually played a role. The whole thing, I mean, the many wars that occurred, the many conflicts, one after another, that played out during this period, it can all be called the First World War in a way. It ended with Nineveh's fall in 612, which must have been a dramatic affair. Maybe not quite like this, painting from 1829 by John Martin, but we look here, for instance, at the skeletons of the fallen soldiers in one of the gates at Nineveh. You can sort of really visualize how terrible it must have been when the enemy troops entered the palaces of the Assyrian kings at Nineveh. They actually acted out their hatred for these former overlords of theirs by hacking away the faces of both the kings and the queens. Now, politics, of course, were important. What were the underlying factors for the fall? Some have argued that it was climate change, and indeed there are indications that, as I already mentioned, that rainfall became again more scarce during the 7th century, but it became scarce early in the 7th century already, so that I'm personally not entirely convinced that in this case it's really the decisive factor. I do think what happened was kind of a perfect storm. There were these the Medes, the Babylonians, both had learned from the Assyrians how to fight them. And there were these internal factors, the weakness of the reign of Ashurbanipal in his later years at least, and of the kings who followed him. At any rate, the Assyrian kingdom, the Assyrian empire, really ended in 612 and 609. But of course, this was not, and again, you all who are sitting here know that better than anyone else, this was not the end of Assyrian civilization. It was only the end of Assyrian statehood. It's actually striking that in the city of Ashur, we have from the 2nd century AD, that is 800 years after the fall of the city of Ashur in 614, still evidence for continuity of Neo-Assyrian artistic traditions, these stelae with these rounded tops, for instance. And from inscriptions, we know that certain festivals, for instance, the Akito festival that was celebrated during the reign of Sennacherib, for instance, in the first days of the month of Nisanu, were still celebrated at exactly the same time. And again, something that all of you know perhaps better than I do. We look at the history of the Assyrian Church of the East. There are, of course, elements absorbed from ancient Assyria into, well, legendary stories of saints who would convert the children of King Sennacherib and so on and so forth, where ancient Assyrian history resonates. In Edessa, in late antiquity, in around 500, according to classical and Syriac sources, the ancient myths were recited on exactly the day, the 8th of Nisanu, on which they were also recited in ancient Assyrian times. So there is continuity. I have no authority nor the time to talk about this later history. I want to end, because I'm afraid it can't be done without, with something, of course, deeply troubling and sad, and that is the destruction of many Assyrian sites by ISIS in 2015 and 2016. Here you see photos of the demolition of the Northwest Palace of Ashurnasirpal II in Kalach. But I don't want to end entirely on such a sad note. Instead, here what you can see is only 2 years after the liberation of Mosul from ISIS, a team of German and Iraqi archaeologists excavating in the palace of Asarhaddon at Nineveh, at Nabi Yunus, a team headed by Peter Miglo. So the good news is that our research on Assyria continues and more finds are being made. We'll have to write better histories than the one I have tried to write in the future, histories that are based on new questions, of course, but also based on new finds. And with that, I think I have spoken long enough. I would like to thank you all for your attention and would be happy to field any questions you may have if there's time for that.
Well, thank you, Professor Frahm. That was a very insightful presentation on sort of a timeline of the ancient Assyrian Empire. I know, speaking from personal experience, I'm sure many other people in the audience can relate, at times it's been quite difficult to find online resources, academic resources on the earlier periods, especially of the Assyrian Empire. So that was very, very valuable. With that being said, I'll open up to any questions that anyone in the audience has on the book itself or the presentation. If you just raise your hand, Ralph will kindly come around with the microphone. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor, for the lecture. One question just I want to ask. Is there any like clay or tablet from Assyrian Empire that written in Aramaic? Because I can see this interchange all the time, but to be honest, I just need an evidence that there was an Assyrian written speaking Aramaic. Because yeah, in absolutely. The time of empire, there's like, I know they change from cuneiform to the alphabetic, but was that in Assyrian language or in Aramaic language?
So from the imperial period, we have primarily texts written in Assyrian or, for that matter, in the Babylonian language. These would be Eastern Semitic languages. But we also have a few tablets, actually a few is not enough, some 70, 80 or so, that are entirely written, inscribed in Aramaic. These are texts mostly from the western portion of the empire, from places such as Ma'alana Ata or the important site of Durkat Limu on the lower Khabur River. And these would be loan documents, legal documents about the sale of real estate and so on. So some of these texts are written entirely in Aramaic. Other texts are written in Assyrian cuneiform and in the Assyrian language, but they have actually epigraphs in Aramaic. So, for instance, they would add to the cuneiform text the personal names of the major, sellers or buyers in those texts, so that anyone who wasn't perhaps able to read cuneiform would immediately see that this tablet mentions so-and-so and would be able to identify the text as being relevant for some later transaction or so. So yes, you do have texts in Aramaic from the imperial period, texts inscribed on clay. Of course, after the fall, I'm pretty sure that writing continued in Assyria, but I do think then people began to write exclusively on leather and on papyrus, and that has not been preserved.
Another question, Eckart?
Oh, okay, thank you. Well, thank you very much, Professor, for like your ardent and pedantic approach, like shedding the light on such a significant but yet overshadowed and sometimes like largely vaguely known about civilization and history of the Assyria. I have like several questions, but just one comes to mind is, So we celebrate 6,773 years this year, on April 1st every year, since the beginning of the civilization. I'm happy also to hear a little bit of your comments on that. Like you touched on the Babylonians being one of the factors in the demise of the Assyrian civilization, but also altogether they would have been all one big civilization, at least in their ancestry and in their beginning. And on that point, there were lots of other like interesting not stories, but I wanted to touch on a few points. One was the connection between the Assyrians and the Egyptians. Like they wasn't a animosity, but there was some kind of a friendship or like. But why I'm saying that is because it's also touching on the point of the demise. Like one of the reasons in the demise was the Babylonians invasion, but also another one was on the Egyptians and the Persians and the Judeans interfering. And so I just wanted to hear a little bit about of comments on what do you think about the beginning of the civilization, also on later on maybe some comments on the Egyptian and Persian connection with them. Thank you.
Yeah, these are big questions. I try to be concise. They're very good questions because they are very important. I think the relationship between Assyria and Babylonia is particularly significant, and I would describe it as a love-hate relationship. But perhaps really primarily a love relationship, because the Assyrians are very capable of adopting things from elsewhere where they seem to be helpful for them. And they're not myopic at all. They realize, for instance, that the Babylonians were leading in terms of cuneiform writing and religious activities of various kinds. They adopt many of these elements and adapt them at the same time. So it's not like they're copying them. It's not a copy and paste affair, but they draw on them. So Babylonia, in some regards, is a model for Assyria. That said, though, the Assyrians, of course, in the first millennium, at the very latest, become the predominant political power, and they are willing to grant Babylonia all sorts of privileges, tax privileges, a certain amount of independence on the level of urban centers, but they do expect that in return the Babylonians accept Assyrian hegemony. And that doesn't always work out. So there are then a number of very high-charge wars fought out between Assyria and Babylonia under Sennacherib and also under Ashurbanipal. So that later on, the Babylonians probably do feel like they have to take revenge against Assyria in 612. With Egypt, it's again the similar situation. The Assyrians are actually really interested in Egyptian civilization. So Asarhadon says that he brought quite a few specialists over from Egypt after he conquered Egypt in 671. So priests and magicians, but certainly also silversmiths, artists, craftsmen. And we know that many Egyptians actually even lived in Assyria before that. We have evidence, for instance, for Egyptian women who lived in Ashur investing in the business ventures of an Assyrian merchant by the name of Duri Ashur during the Neo-Assyrian period. So the man was selling textiles and hats to people in the Tur Abdin for wine and brought the wine then back on rafts. And again, this was all sold for profit. And these Egyptian women, as we know from clay tablets from his archive, invested in this. With the Judeans, it's yet again a complex relationship. You know there is this interesting passage in the Bible about the Assyrian Rabshakeh, an important general, speaking apparently in Hebrew to the people at Jerusalem during the siege of Jerusalem in 701. So this has led some people to speculate that there were maybe even family ties between the Judean royal family and the Assyrian royal family. Now, this can't be proven, but it is interesting that there is someone who knows the language of Judah. And the Judeans during the 7th century, especially in the reign of Manasseh, actually are faithful vassals of Assyria. They help the Assyrians, for instance, on their campaigns against Egypt. So they provide troops. The Persians eventually, of course, their empire is only founded some 70 years or so after the demise of the Assyrian Empire. And the Persians succeed the Babylonian Empire of Nabopolassar and Nebuchadnezzar. However, and that's also interesting, it seems as though the model empire for the Persians is not the predecessor empire, the Babylonian Empire, but rather the Assyrian Empire. They must have seen Assyrian art somewhere, and they must have heard many stories about the Assyrian Empire. And for them, for the Persians, Assyria was the real model and not Babylonia. So Assyria, and that's another legacy I think that's really important, Assyria is this model empire, really. It provides the blueprint for this form of government that then for centuries and centuries, and of course, essentially until today, is one of the geopolitical, the forms of geopolitical organization that really are of extremely great significance.
Okay, right, we've got a few more questions.
Thank you, Professor. Shlama, or peace be with you. We have a unique phenomenon with us, and that is our name, which is the name of our god, Ashur, name of our city, Ashur, and we are named Ashur, or Ashurai, or Assyrians. So my first question is, in the beginning, did our ancestor name the city after their god, or their god after their city? This is remains a mystery even to us to this day. And following that is the name of our language. We know from inscriptions from the time of Shamshi-Adad, and I'm quoting other Assyriologists, that our ancestors called their language Lishano Akkaditi or Lishano Ashuriti, just were two dialects maybe of the same language. So I'm just gonna reword the previous question. Is there any cuneiform evidence that our ancestors called their name, their language, sorry, anything else other than these two names? Thank you again. And I also acknowledge the minister and his effort to organize this. Thank you.
Yeah, Shlomo, indeed. Your first question about Ashur is impossible to answer, I think. In my view, the two, the city that is, and the god are inextricably linked. In a way, the city and the god are one at the beginning. That's what the Romans would have called a numen loci. So the divinity is the city. And in this seal inscription I showed you by Tzilulu, it is actually written with a determinative for city. So it is written as though it would say the city of Ashur is king. So the distinction between city and god at the very beginning can probably not be made. So my answer would be it's both. And of course, later on, the god Ashur undergoes a number of transformations and metamorphoses. He's identified with the Babylonian king of the gods, Enlil. This is another example of Babylonian civilization being absorbed some way by Assyrians. And then even later, there are elements of the god Marduk are projected onto him. But at the same time, he also stays who he is in many ways. And he remains throughout Assyrian history and even beyond the history of the Assyrian state, the god of Ashur, of course. He's still worshipped in 200 AD in that very city. The language, Aramean. I think one thing that's important to keep in mind is that what happens in Assyria during imperial times is not what happens in Roman times during the Roman Empire. In Roman times, you have Romanization. So what the Romans do when they conquer, Gaul, they make sure their language is now the one that's predominant. French, essentially a late version of Latin. the local languages disappear. In Assyria, it's different. The Aramean language is the one that eventually prevails and it becomes a world language. A recent book by Czella, Munich theologian, actually on the history of the Aramaic language so far. I think it's only available in German, but I think it is supposed to be translated into English as well. So what you can observe in Assyria is that the Assyrian language, which is East Semitic and is of course related to Aramaic, but is a different language, is closer related to what you call the Lishan Akkadi, to the Akkadian language, like Babylonian. So those are really sister languages, maybe you could even say dialects. It's slightly marginalized. In the 7th century, it really seems as though Aramaic becomes the predominant language. We have a lot of letters from the reign of Sargon. The number of letters from later reigns in cuneiform and in the Assyrian language decreases, probably because people are now writing in Aramaic. So again, this cultural union between Arameans and Assyrians is there from early onwards. Initially, of course, these are two different groups. The Arameans are invaders, but soon enough, there is essentially, cultural koine. There's a communion between the Arameans and the Assyrians, which becomes stronger and stronger, and eventually Assyrians and Arameans are almost indistinguishable. And the post-imperial inscriptions, of course, are all written in an Eastern Aramaic dialect. So the texts that I mentioned that talk about the god Ashur in the 2nd century AD, they're written in this Eastern Aramaic dialect and Aramaic script and so on.
Thank you, Eckart. We've got a few more questions.
First of all, thank you for your valuable time, and thank you for Minister Krizwan for organizing this very informative event. I have two questions. My first question, only a few civilizations were found before the Assyrian civilization. Among of these civilizations were the Sumerian civilization as well as the Akkadian. My question is, how close were the Assyrians to the Akkadian and the Sumerian genetically and culturally? That's my first question. Second question, during your lecture, you referred to a couple of biblical resources. How accurate are the biblical resources when it comes to Assyrian history? Thank you.
Thank you for that question. Yeah. So Sumerian is a language that's isolated. No one speaks a language related to Sumerian. And the Sumerians are really, as far as we can tell, the people who invented cuneiform around 3,500 or so BCE. But from very early onwards, perhaps even then, and certainly during the early second millennium BCE, the Sumerians were closely associated with the Akkadians. And the Akkadians, of course, spoke a Semitic language that is very closely related to later Assyrian. In fact, both Babylonian and Assyrian are offshoots of the Akkadian language, with Assyrian, in fact, probably being a little closer to old Akkadian than Babylonian. So the Assyrians, it seems, at least based on linguistic criteria, would be closer to the old Akkadians than the Babylonians were. The Sumerians influenced and Akkadians too influenced Ashur culturally. So I mentioned that the coats worn by some of these figurines from the Ishtar temple from the earliest layers of Ashur show an influence from the south. And Babylonian culture remains something that inspires Assyrian culture throughout the ages. The Bible, I would actually say that the Bible is actually quite accurate when it comes to what it has to say about Assyria. Second King is where we, I think, can say with great confidence where what the Bible has to say is grosso modo actually correct, historically correct. I'm speaking here as an historian, of course, and I know full well that, of course, the Bible has all sorts of other connotations and can be read in all sorts of other ways, and that it should probably really not be read primarily as an history book. But of course, for the historian, it is a history book, first and foremost, and you asked me about that. And what I would, for instance, point out is that the Bible identifies correctly the names of quite a few Assyrian kings, starting with Tiglath-Pileser III, not by chance, because with him, the Assyrian Empire really in the proper way comes into being. And it is Tiglath-Pileser who, for the first time, fights, really in Israel, in the kingdom of Israel, and is the king who significantly diminishes the size of that kingdom. So starting with Tiglath-Pileser and then continuing with Shalmaneser V and with Sargon and Sennacherib, Esarhaddon, and even Ashurbanipal, all those kings are mentioned in the Bible. And of course, the texts in the Hebrew Bible about the Assyrians were later on edited, and we can find various theological interpretations of events they describe. For instance, there's this statement when it comes to the campaign by Sennacherib against Jerusalem that in one night, the angel of the Lord cut down 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. So that would be a theological interpretation from later times, most likely, of, however, what in truth was not the conquest of Jerusalem. It is important to keep in mind that the Assyrians did not conquer Jerusalem. They eventually left the city without having conquered it and instead were happy with Hezekiah, the Judean king, sending them tribute to Nineveh. So even here where, we clearly find theological agendas in the Bible, we also find a reflection of history. And I mean, sometimes there's really a remarkable amount of detail that the Bible gets right. Sometimes so much detail that the Bible is still a source that provides us with information we find nowhere else. For instance, the murder of Sennacherib, who was killed by his own sons, are known only from the Bible. These were a certain Odamulisi, that's a name also known from cuneiform sources, and a man by the name of Shah Etzer, and that's clearly an Assyrian name, Shah Utso. And this son is known only from the Bible. There's no reason why the Bible should have invented such a son. There would have been no theological reason for that. So in this case, I would say the Bible is really an important source, an important historical source for the reconstruction of Assyrian history.
Thank you, Professor Frahm, and what an interesting question. We don't want to keep you too much longer because we know it's quite early in the morning for you, but we will take one last question.
We can auction the question off. No, that's okay. By all means.
You want it? You want a question?
Hello, and thank you for sharing your, I guess, knowledge and research with us today. For us, I think it's kind of takes us aback that someone that isn't Assyrian has cared enough to put something together, which we will look into and read to learn from. I have two questions. It's up to you if you want to answer both. I know you're tired. My first one is, with the Assyrian language, obviously we now speak Neo-Aramaic, which is a new language compared to what they were speaking of the time you have researched. My question as to why this happened in your research, did you find a time in history that there was a reason for it? And secondly, what was your motivation to write this book? Because it's a lot of research and it's a lot of commitment on your end, but I'm curious to find out as to why. Thank you.
Yeah, so the language that I sense, and don't worry about me being tired. I'm kind of a night person anyway, so that's okay. The language question is complicated. The earliest documents inscribed, at least in part in Aramaic, are from the 8th century BCE. Well, we know, of course, that Arameans had infiltrated northern Iraq much earlier. The first references actually to Arameans is not under the name Aramean, but under the name Ahlamu, and that's already in the 13th century BCE. So this is when, for the first time, we hear of this group of Semitic speaking people somewhere in the West, where exactly is not so clear, of course, probably never really been known, but they become a major player in ancient Near Eastern history, really essentially in the 11th century with their infiltration of this region. And then again, it's a slow process, this emergence of Aramaic as a world language. And again, it really becomes a world language. It's up to the rise of Arabic in the 7th century. And even beyond that, Aramaic is the language that's the lingua franca in the Middle East. And it becomes the lingua franca probably already in late Assyrian times. Perhaps because it was practical. Indeed, of course, the Aramaic alphabet is much easier to learn than the very, very complicated cuneiform writing system. Why exactly this happens, of course, we can't know. I mean, there are no sources telling us that now sort of reform was implemented and from now on, people would write only in Aramaic. We have one letter from the late 8th century from the reign of Sargon II, in which he actually asks a correspondent of his from Babylonia to write to him in cuneiform and not in Aramaic. So at this point, it seems the prestige of cuneiform was still such that it prevailed also in state correspondence. But there was already a move towards this new language. And this new language then eventually is the one that takes over, and probably already during the Neo-Babylonian Empire, and certainly, I mean, during the Persian Empire, this very, very important and large empire, four times as large as the Assyrian, that lasted from 539 BCE until 331 BCE when Alexander conquered Persia. The official language of communication, both in Egypt and in Afghanistan, fundamentally from both these places, we have documents, was not Persian, was not anything cuneiform, was not Egyptian hieroglyphs, it was Aramaic. Everyone wrote Imperial Aramaic, as it was then called. And again, that starts in Assyria. So this is an important moment in world language development, so to speak. You kindly asked what motivated me to write this book. Well, I have studied Assyria from really very early onwards. I wrote my dissertation about the Assyrian king Sennacherib, and I have always found it really fascinating for a variety of reasons. I mean, I have today focused on the global dimensions of Assyrian history, the fact that it is this world empire. I should also perhaps emphasize again, it was alluded to a couple of times, that it is in the shadow of Assyria, that in the periphery, so to speak, that the first monotheistic religion of mankind in Judah emerges. And that happens, of course, in response in many ways to, encounters with the Assyrian Empire. I think the Assyrian Empire plays an important role here as well. So I would say this is something that matters. I also find it fascinating because there are so many sources. I mean, of course, in this very short lecture, I could really only touch somewhat superficially on some key moments. But I mean, my book includes a chapter on just one year, the year 671, from which you have an enormous amount of texts, many, many letters exchanged by the king with his scholars, exchanged by the king with various generals and administrators, a huge amount of royal inscriptions in providing great detail about what was going on. And then, of course, from about the same time, we have gigantic libraries with especially Ashurbanipal's library is, of course, with almost anything you could wish. I mean, these are the earliest medical texts we have, lots and lots of religious texts, literature. The Gilgamesh epic is a fascinating text, but still best known from manuscripts from Assyrian libraries, but also many, many other epics and myths, even sort of humorous texts poking fun at physicians and and mayas and so on. This is really a lot of stuff. Scholarly texts, the earliest commentaries, the Assyrians and the Babylonians of the first millennium were the first in the world to actually write about their own texts or tradition. By that time, sometimes some 2,000 years old. I myself studied these. I have a project, the Cuneiform from Commentaries project, where you can read up on these things. It's quite similar, actually, the way they study these texts to what rabbinical scholars did with the Hebrew Bible. So there are lots of interesting things, and I find it particularly interesting to bring these different aspects together. That is to try to find out how, let's say, scholarship and politics are related, but of course also, let's say, how environmental factors influence history. And I mean, I should again reiterate, I'm very honored that I was invited by the Minister of Climate Change to give this lecture. And I would like to thank Mr. Bowen for the invitation. And I hope, I mean, you have seen that, of course, Assyria is a place where the study of phenomena such as climate change or the impact of epidemics might actually provide insights on how to manage such, tribulations even today. I mean, I don't want to overdo the parallels, and history doesn't repeat itself. But I mean, as we all know, it rhymes. And I do think Assyria really holds lessons, apart from being a very exciting and sometimes even entertaining world, that matter. And then, of course, for all of you, I know full well that this is the case. I had a student who was a modern Assyrian, and she is now an assistant professor in Amsterdam. I mean, you have a more immediate connection to this world than, of course, I do and anyone. And I respect that, and I find it exciting. And I'm particularly pleased, of course, also have given this lecture to this audience for that very reason.
Well, thank you, Professor. Before we conclude this evening's proceedings, I'd just like to make a quick comment that I'm sure everyone else in the audience resonates with this as well, but it's really refreshing to hear an academic of your stature acknowledge us as the modern descendants and as Assyrians. It hasn't always been the case throughout modern history. So thank you for that. And thank you for taking the time out of your morning today to speak with us. I'd like to now pass over to Ms. Adarina Shaheen, a representative of the Assyrian National Council of Australia, to conclude with a vote of thanks.
Reverend Father Raman Yohannes, Honourable Chris Bowen, MP, Professor Eckart Frahm, ladies and gentlemen, it's with great pleasure and a profound sense of belonging to our Assyrian nation that I stand before you tonight on this occasion hosted by the Honourable Chris Bowen, MP. Mr. Bowen has been a dedicated and unwavering supporter of the Assyrian community, so we're greatly thankful for continued commitment. In this evening, we've had the privilege of exploring our rich and ancient history of the Assyrian Empire with a distinguished guest, Mr. Professor Eckart Frahm, the author of the insightful book, Assyria, The Rise and Fall of the World's First Empire. Despite the geographical distances that separate us and the time zone. Thank you, Mr. Frahm, for joining us via Zoom and sharing your knowledge and expertise. Assyria is a testament to Mr. Frahm's dedication to unraveling the epic story of this ancient empire. It offers a comprehensive account of the rise and fall of the Assyrian Empire, stretching from the Mediterranean Sea to the Persian Gulf, a monumental achievement in history. Professor Frahm's work not only examines into the battles and conquests, but also uncovers the tapestry of Assyrian existence, from vast libraries to monumental sculptures, elaborate trade networks, and the pivotal role played by royal women. As we explore the pages of Assyria, we gain a deeper appreciation of the enduring legacy of this great civilization, which transcends time and has influenced empires and cultures that followed. Professor's work is a testament to the enduring importance of understanding our ancient world. On behalf of the Assyrian National Council of Australia and our valued audience present here, I want to express our gratitude to Professor Frahm for sharing his profound insights and to Mr. Bowen for facilitating this enlightening conversation.
It's events like this that help us preserve and celebrate our rich cultural heritage. It's important for us all to continue exploring the legacy of the Assyrian Empire and to seek out opportunities for cultural enrichment and understanding. Together, we can ensure that the history of our great civilization remains alive and thriving. Once again, thank you, Mr. Bowen. Thank you, Professor Frahm, and good evening.
Eckart, we might just take a group photo if that's okay. Yep. I can invite everybody if you want to take a group photo in front of Mr. Eckart, if you'd like to come and join along. Yeah, I think we can group up a little bit.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we might get some more in the middle. Yeah. Yeah. If you want to come in the middle too. Yeah. That's fine. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Just leave it there. One. Yeah. Okay. 3, 2, 1. I'll take one of Mr. David's phone as well. Be with me. 3, 2, 1. Thank you all. Thank you very much. Bear with me one moment. I can't see if the minister would like to just say hello or thank you. Just 1 second, Eckart. Minister will just quickly say hello.
Sure. Pleasure.
He can't hear you. Oh, he can. Eckart, can you hear?
You gotta conclude the.
Yeah.
The,
yeah. No, I can. Okay. I can.
Ask for his email address.
I've got it. Yeah. Hey, Eckart, that was great. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation. I really appreciate it.
No worries. There's a lot of interest in buying your book here. It's hard to get, so we might have to see what we can work out. Maybe we'll put in a bulk order or something.
I'll let my publishers know. I mean, they should somehow get more copies to Australia, it seems.
Yeah. We'll see what we can work out. Maybe if you let your booksellers know that you've got a lot of interest and if they want to email me, we'll work out how to get the people here a copy and they can buy it.
Yeah, I appreciate also that you're trying to get the book sold for me, so that's much appreciated. I'm glad it came eventually.
Yes,
it reached you. So
yeah, your one. I'm glad you sent me one because I'm still waiting for my copy.
that's strange. Yeah,
yeah.
I let these Bloomsbury people know. I mean,
I mean, you know, Australia's a long way away, and we're not a huge market compared to America or Europe, so they don't prioritize us. But you know, there's plenty of interest here.
No, I'm really glad to hear it. And I mean, I know that Australia is one of those places where many Assyrians now live. So I'm not that surprised, of course, that there are these communities. But I find it very impressive that you're a busy man. You have lots of things, of course, in your plate, that you have found the time to have an event like this and attend it in person. I'm really very, honored and pleased that you came. And thank you for that and for... Well, bringing everyone together.
No, my pleasure. And if you get to Australia anytime soon, let me know and we'll organise for you to meet some of these people in person, give you a tour of the cathedrals and everything that's here, because I'm sure you'd find it interesting.
I would really like that. I hope one day I'll manage to do this. I've yes. never been to Australia, but I've made it to Singapore. So it
oh, well,
that way then.
Yeah,
and
it's just another 8 hours from Singapore. You get to Singapore, yeah. you can come all the way.
Right.
All right, wonderful. We'll let you go and maybe get some sleep. But thank you so much. And I'll be in contact on email.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. And have a good evening. Bye-bye.
Good on you. Same to you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Eckart. Thank you.
Thank you, Raffaele, and thank you for organizing it all so smoothly.
Sure.
Was it possible to understand me and everything?
No. The presentation was fantastic. We could hear you perfectly. Your answers were amazing as well. So from the bottom of our hearts, thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Okay, thanks. Then have a nice evening too. Thank you again.
Yep.
And good night. Bye-bye.
Good night. Make sure you get a good 8 hours.
Yeah, I have my first meeting at 9. So, but okay,
thank you, Eckart. Thank you.
It's all right. Good night.
Have a good night. Bye.